Welcome to 2 Month Review, the weekly podcast brought to you by Open Letter and 3%, in which we take one giant book, break it down bit by bit, section by section, analyze it, discuss it, have fun, make jokes. I'm Chad Post from Open Letter Books, joined as always by Brian Wood, author of Joypen Killbox.
Hi, Chad. You kind of sounded, that intro when you went in there, you kind of sounded like somebody that, like, their whole week is leading up to getting to be the MC of trivia.
Yep.
Like nerd trivia.
Hey, welcome to Trivia Night at the Huddle. Huh? I'm here tonight. We've got golf pencils up front. Make sure you return them, though, because we do need them back. And make sure you
had like this very...
Are you thinking like, are you making fun of Ryan Chapman right now?
No, I'm saying you sound like a C-list game show host.
I know. I like looking into it. It was like the first note was along that. The first note was that. I had to do that. How impersonations happen. By accident.
I'm doing much better than I deserve. How are you doing?
I'm doing okay. I've got some concerns about things related to business and the future of the world, but you know, sure. Here now.
Usually when you say something, you start high-pitched and then say something that usually means an absolute lie. Hey, so tell me, how was my one-man show?
It was
cool.
Great.
I gotta tell you, I'm usually not a one-man show kind of person, but wow. When you started doing that, when you started pretending to be your mom and your childhood self, talking back and forth, that was awesome.
Let's make fun of verbal tics all show.
Why not? I'm just excited to observe somebody and get to talk to somebody other than
walking the baby through the neighborhood. It's like every person who walks by, I'm like, you're the most fascinating creature I've ever seen. What is your scene?
Yeah.
This is really wild. Well, this season we're doing The Dream Part by Rodrigo Frazan, translated from the Spanish by Will Vanderheiden. And today we're specifically talking up to page 424. There's a lot of good shit in this section.
Especially if you like Nabokov. Yeah.
We hit lucky. I forgot where he stopped last time. That was 362. Sure.
I have it dog-eared. Let's see here.
I saw some tweet about like appropriate and inappropriate ways to bookmark your books, and the one that was like chaotic evil was dog earing things, and I'm like, man, you should see my books. They're all dog eared and folded over.
Well, yeah, I mean, you can go like the deeper you dog ear, the more important it must be because it really saves the spot, right?
And then if you dog ear and flip it back, it means you want to know both pages.
Yeah, I don't know. Yes, three. You are correct. It was 362.
Yeah, 362. Anyway, so what did you think about this part as a whole? I've got like lots of fun stuff for this section.
There was a neat part of it that talked about like reading, like seeing it and reading it, right? Like, or I'm saying it wrong. I'm paraphrasing it, but this is one of those ones where like looking at the words and then making sentences out of those words and then trying to like I want to go back and read it again so I can really see it. Because this almost reads as like an epistle or an essay or something like a letter, and there's so much dense information and I want to kind of go back and learn more about it. But right now I'm just plugging straight ahead, so
yeah.
I'll have to come back later.
But, I think there are like four question marks. I was trying to look things up when I was doing stuff this morning. I was finishing it, but Alex wanted to sit on my lap as I was reading, so I'm like trying to write notes. And he's like sitting on my lap. I'm like, oh my God, this is not going to happen. But this is a great part that like seems to be sort of like the writer's vitriolic take on bad reading and bad writing and unpopular trendy writing.
Well, that writing. And then at the end of it, like his, like looking back on his body of work. And I thought that was wonderful. What happens in this section plot wise? I wasn't even paying attention. Plot. Is there a plot in this?
I
know he goes to the sleeping center place or whatever, but
yeah, it explains, it recontextualizes the first part, okay. big part thing that he's going there because he has insomnia, and mm-hmm. so he's made up the omnarium and like why he would be going there for that, but that in reality they're like quote unquote trying to study his insomnia, which. It was like last Saturday, Sunday, Monday, I couldn't sleep at all. I like was losing my mind. So like to have insomnia for any extended period is like, seems brutal to me. It only happens to me every so often. It'll happen for like a few days in a row, but like I am so out of it after that.
Yeah, I've been sleeping on the couch since May 11th, and my back is all jacked up. Which I mean, like
May 11th.
What's that? Yeah, I mean, it's like crazy first world problems. Oh, I have to sleep on my couch is too soft. My back doesn't like it. But it's like, oh man, I'm all thrown off.
Very true. Very true.
We have a small house, and I have to be quarantined from my spouse, and so I can't sleep in bed next to them. So
I was wondering about that, and I was trying to calculate the probability that you're infected.
It's about 100%. It's probably 100%.
But I was like, it's impossible to be 100. So like, how close to 100 is it? I kept like cutting out certain things and trying to make it work. It's a very interesting like thing to do. Oh, before I forget, I want to talk about this, but you bent for 2 seconds.
Okay. Yeah. With the whole coronavirus or whatever, I was reading something. There's that book Band of Brothers, and this one lieutenant was trying to tell one of the privates, like, in order to be a good soldier, like the trick is to know that you're already dead. And then once you know you're already dead, it's really easy to just do what you have to do, because you know. And so with this whole thing, I'm just like, yeah, I've got it. I'm gonna give it to my daughter, and of course my wife had, like, we just have it, whatever. It's so. Stay away from everybody. Don't breathe. Don't look at anybody. And so, I know it's. I already know I'm dead, so it's fine. It's like that's the silver lining of. I already know I'm gonna have it, or I already have had it. Whatever.
So, yep. I've sort of put myself in that camp. The thing I wanted to tell you about is this isn't mentioned in here at all. Is it true novel by Mizumura? That's not mentioned at all in the dream part, has it been? I don't think so.
It may have. I didn't pay close enough attention.
Okay. So this is a book that is Japanese, by a Japanese author who's written a few books that have been translated into English. And this was the most recent novel of hers to be translated. It was originally written in 2002. And it is a retelling of Wuthering Heights through a Japanese lens. But what's really interesting about it, it's two volumes. It's like 800 pages. If anyone wants to buy this, it was a fairly popular book. It was on the best translated book award list. But it always seemed very long to me, so I just never picked it up. But for this, I was like, oh, I want to read this because it ties into what we're doing with Wuthering Heights for Dream Part. And like, that seems very interesting to me right now, this kind of retelling of the story. And if anyone wants to order it, the two volumes is out of print, but you can get it as one book, but it's like print on demand. So it's kind of a tricky one to find. You just have to order it through their website, through Other Press's website. And I'll link to that. But the first 160 some pages are the prologue to the story. But here's where it's interesting. So it's all about the writer, Mizumura, about her life and how she, like, as a kid, knew this guy who'd come from Japan. He left. He became apparently very, 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 very wealthy, like super wealthy, through like a series of things involving medical equipment and then venture capitalism and whatever. And he's got like some sort of smoky, mysterious past. And at the end of it, this kid comes and is like, well, I met him and this crazy shit happened. I need to tell you this story because I know that he knew you. He mentioned that he knew you. And this unnerved me, this meeting that I had with him this like week. And so he tells her the story, which you don't get relayed, but it's gone through her whole, like, how she's a writer, how she has written these two books, where she's teaching in Southern California, all this maps onto her real life. And then she's like, well, I'm going to write this and I'm going to use Wuthering Heights as sort of the trope, but like, I can't just make Wuthering Heights transplanted in Japan. So there's things that are going with it, but there's this tradition in Japan between the I novel and the true novel. And a true novel is like the fictionalized one that's all fiction and created, but the I novel is what's most popular, is writing about yourself and writing about your own being and like the own travails that you've gone through, the own problems that you've had. And that's the more popular version of a novel. So she's trying to figure out how to write not that, but not also just imitate Wuthering Heights. But as it comes out through that explanation, that first 160 pages is that I novel about her life and about herself and how she came to be a writer. So it not only like mapped on with the Wuthering Heights part, but it was kind of like really talking to the dream part idea and the invented part idea of the author creating things and creating something out of experiences that they've had, out of themselves, and out of things that they've learned from other people.
Wow. You tried so hard not to say autofiction just then, huh?
That she doesn't say it, so I'm avoiding it. there's going to be more about this. If everything goes according to plan, I have a crazy, one of my crazy posts coming soon.
Okay.
It will dovetail with that. But I wanted to bring it up for people who are listening and following along as another Wuthering Heights example, and one that actually it seems very interesting and in a different way that hasn't been mentioned.
And I just love that it's like a 160 page prologue, you said?
Well, it's like a novel.
It reads amazing.
Like it reads its own separate novel. And then it's like, okay, now the novel's going to start. But this first novel was just like setting it up. Yeah, it's really funny.
No, now that my preamble's finished, let's get into the book. What the? It took me a week to read the.
to be fair, the book reads super fast and there's not a lot of words on the page. So like if it were printed like this is, I bet the whole book is shorter than this.
Yeah. But like, no, I love that. I love that concept.
Me too. Great.
I had a failed story. Well, failed in the fact that I quit working on it, but it was a really short story. And then it was at the end of it had about the typeface. Mm-hmm. And then the story behind the typeface and why it was used for the story ended up being like four times as long as the story itself.
There's this book we desperately want to do, but they won't sell it to us, called The Red Handler by Johan Harstad, in which the first half of it, there are these very short micro detective stories written about this detective named The Red Handler, but they're all made up by this writer. And they're like, he solves the crimes in like a paragraph. So it'll be like, this guy fell from the sky and was dead. I looked up and there was a window. It was open. He had fallen. He was dead. It's like it was designed so that like people who had no attention span could get into reading. But then everything is footnoted and the editor in the back is explaining the author's life and all this crazy shit. So I'll mention a cat and I'll be like, oh, I have a story about a cat. And I'll be just like surrounding the
cat. What a
love
what,
it.
What was the what was the James Patterson, like the super short ones for the airplane?
Book shots.
Yeah, a book shot. What a great. This is like a micro book shot or whatever's the small. What's smaller than a shot? I don't know.
I don't know. I can only do double shots, you know? Bull shots.
Yeah. It's like it's a Reader's Digest book shot.
A Reader's Digest book shot, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I have a good place to start with this. So there's a lot of Nabokov stuff in here, which I actually read some stuff for in preparation for this too, for once. Surprise, surprise. But this is the best. So on page 377, he's talking about the Onanarium and all that kind of stuff and whatever. Now it's composed of a whole choreography of an expert in adolescent bumblings and someone who in addition never fell out of love, so on and so forth. And he says, with good prose and bad words, but as it concerned him, love, a hormonal alteration, a chemical imbalance, and neurological aberration in the end, was always getting closer to being declared an epidemic by the World Health Organization or by one of those organizations that patented plagues in order to subsequently sell pleasant placebos or miraculous cures to the world. And I was like, uh-oh. Yep.
Yeah.
All those things stand up so loud.
Give it a shot. What do you have to lose? What do you have to lose? What do you... Just try it. Just try it. Try it. Okay, I'll try it.
One of my favorite Donald Trump facts that I've learned, which I shared with you this morning, which is just my favorite thing. So he always talks or has talked about how he is particularly good as an athlete and could have been a major league baseball player, which is something that, you know, speaks to me very, very clearly. And so they went and found some of his stats because baseball people have nothing else to do. So we're like, I'm creating spreadsheets for people. I'm like, give me numbers that I can play with. And they found that during his nine games they played for the New York Military Academy, which is against pretty bad competition, which I'll say in a second, he batted 138. And so according to Keith Law, says you don't hit 138 for so podunk cold weather high school playing the worst competition you could possibly imagine. You wouldn't even get recruited for Division I baseball programs, let alone pro teams. That's totally unthinkable. It's absolutely laughable. Trump hit 138. He couldn't fucking hit. That is pretty clear. Which I just want to include that here because I love it.
What's the Mendoza line?
200.
200. Is it just a flat 200?
Flat 200. I think because the Mendoza is 8,200 pounds.
Oh, okay.
Just like that.
Isn't like, I don't know that. I don't know the story behind it. But isn't the Mendoza line like the absolute like minimum you're allowed to hit to remain in the league? Is this player Mendoza that for his career was about a 200 hitter and somehow made a career out of it?
I mean, there's more metrics, obviously. There's a rough thing. It was like, I think it's based on the idea you don't even hit your weight. So like, if you,
you don't hit your weight,
then you're not worth me. So like, I, if I don't okay. have 165, like that's pretty bad.
Okay.
But,
yeah. So I don't think like Trump. I don't know what he weighed in college, but I doubt he hit his weight.
Yeah. No way. No way. Yeah, this is so good because this is the part where he talks about in the terms of the plot where he goes to the laboratory where they're trying to solve the mystery of insomnia to see if they can get back the lost desire to dream. And they're like studying him. They're not really curing him. They're studying him. And at one point from behind the door, he heard them whispering about how he might be the first person impacted by an imminent epidemic. Patient zero in the ground zero of his bed.
I like that one too.
At the point in time are totally different than what we normally jump out at.
Yeah, it's insane. Yeah.
Oh my God. I totally agree with too, where he's thinking about when you're old, you no longer know how you could tell you're old because you no longer know how old young people are. And they all seem to be moving through some imprecise time between 15 and 25 years old and between 25 and 35 and between 15 and 35 years old. And that's what's happening to me. I just look at people. I'm like, you're an age.
I feel like in some ways we kind of separate our ages by what references, particularly pop culture references, you get or don't get, or like who's your Batman? Like, well, mine's Michael Keaton, so that puts me. Well, mine's Adam West, right? Who's Adam West? Oh, forget it. Like, at least the Michael Keaton Bat people will know the Adam West one, right?
Yeah,
but may not have a clue who, you know, that George Clooney played Batman or not. You know, like, is anybody's Batman Val Kilmer? I don't know.
Oh my god. Yeah, no, absolutely not.
But this one, I like this one because there's like the number of literary references are staggering, and it's very fun. It's very fun. This is very like if you're a reader and lover of books, this is a great section for you. But I love that there's these little kind of fill in the blank moments, and you I have to like keep stopping and trying to figure out, oh, I wonder what he wanted to be filled in here or not, and trying to guess like one example. And I would be curious how you would fill this in. He's talking about, it's on page 393, and he's talking about, how terrible it is to have Nabokov as one of your influences. Cause all you realize is that you're never going to be him. Probably the worst influence you can have. But talking about him as an influence, and then a little bit later down, it talks about readership. Readers who'd already passed obedient and evangelized and ever so anxious to be enlightened and to receive their next dose of revelations through professionals like Milan Kundera, W.G. Sebald, Paul Auster, Emmanuel, is it Carrere?
I think so.
Okay. I've read, actually,
I love his
work. And somebody else, and one more.
Oh, I just think
it was the... Within those style of right, who is the somebody else and the one more?
Yeah, I wasn't sure. I read that as like, just like there's always one, there's always a new person that kind of falls into that. But maybe you're right that it's naming someone.
No, I don't know if it's naming someone. I just like the idea of like, you start, it's like, you know, finish this pattern. Here are these like Rushmore writers that are in this vein and this style. Who would you add to that list to it? I just, it's like fun things like that.
It's sort of like the Nabokov Transparent Things thing, like more on that later, or more to come, or whatever it says. I can't remember. It's quoted in here, too.
Yeah.
It's the most Frazanian line. The Enrique Belmonte is there, too.
Yeah, I love that he was jealous even of the hyphen in his last name.
I know. Yeah, Belmonte is a baller last name, man. That is great. I love Enrique Belmonte, although I've not read his most recent one. But this is where this whole sort of thesis of this part, or whatever you want to call it, motif of this part starts to hit. We're talking about readership and the relationship to art. A reader with an almost compulsive need to have them read to him first and explain to him after, and in the end make him feel so well read. The reader, like one of those tourists who learns guidebooks by heart and rarely takes the risk of leaving the routes pre-established by his or her host country. Is like, there's a book that Curtis Wright wrote when I was working at Delkey that was published by HarperCollins, but like Harper West or whatever it is, Harper One. And it's called The Middle Mind. And it was all about like the NPRification of culture and commerce coming together, where you don't want things that are really good and things that are really poppy and schlocky get made fun of. But the things that are like in, they're like the NPR where you listen and you're like, I feel informed now. I'm aware. Like Terry Gross embodies like making art digestible in a way that makes you feel like you're slightly above the average, but you're not like pretentious because that would be or elitist or no, because that's like not cool. It's cool to just be like slightly above the others at the cocktail party.
Cloud Atlas. I read Cloud Atlas.
I love Cloud Atlas, man. I love.
No, David it's Martin. Good. No, it's a great book. But I think it's in that vein where you feel like you're well read and you feel good about reading it, right? Yeah. Like you went to church and you have that good feeling of like, oh, I got my message for the day. I feel good. Everybody else is on the couch.
I got my host and my blood of Christ to protect me from the coronavirus.
That's right.
Hey, God don't.
But no, Corona. It's so fun. Like I feel like he's like an insult comic or like a roaster that's like really good at kind of like just putting his thumb against you, because when that little quick list like Immortality by Milan Kundera is when I was like first like this is not required reading any of my classes, but I'm gonna read this book. Oh, I feel so good. Like this is a writer from Europe.
Yeah.
I'm not reading Fight Club. I'm reading Milan Kundera.
Could say, yeah.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. That. And then the other one was when I read The Mustache by Emmanuel, and like, oh, what a cool, like, I love this kind of long story novella type thing. But it's like, oh, geez, man. He's like, pick me apart here with his paragraph. What asshole.
So many good books for artists, but the one that's interesting in relation to this is the one where he envisions himself as Philip K. Dick. And it's like the life of Dick through like an imagined biography.
Yeah, where, that biography that he did.
Yeah, it's like an autobiography. Like it's pretty cool. I read that so many years ago.
Did he do that one before the Russian novel one? Was that him as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
What is that called? Whatever it is.
My Life as a Russian Novel or something like that.
Something like that. Yeah. I can't remember now. But that goes, that kind of thing gets picked up again on the next page of 395, where he talks about IKEA and IKEA's thing. And the trick of like that the difference between IKEA's thing and the other guy's thing and so many other people's things was that he never came up with that kind of awful, excellent idea. He's talking about the writer never came up with one of those ideas that everyone's like, oh yeah, this is perfect. No, he was like one of those spectators who has perfect knowledge of the truth behind the illusion. And for that reason, could never feel magical or like a magician. The trick of those products was perfectly clear to him. And maybe that's why he couldn't create them with enough conviction to convince the reading public. So it starts to have that self-critique that goes on in here of like how his stories, he could never toss off something that's like using that sort of cool idea that people will be like, oh, that's awesome. I'm going to read that and I'll love that. Like he knows too much and is too direct and too truthful or writing too many truths about that to be able to make one of those things that would make him a popular writer. And to have an audience. He's like against an audience, but he's just not capable of doing something. And I love that where he writes finally like his book, which is like referred to as like it's basically sounds like the invented part. And it's like, oh yeah, it breaks through and everyone loves it and he gets all this attention. And it's like, but that was all a lie. That was an alternate universe. Oh man.
Yeah. Good ideas that seem to him almost unthinkable. I like that.
I do too. It's so good. So good.
Yeah, because it's like to break out, there has to be some sort of hook, right, that you can capture the audience with.
Yeah.
Like what's the high concept image or just something like, oh, it's Jaws in space. All right, cool. I'll read that. Like, you know.
Will it make
or whatever.
Cocktail party?
Yeah, exactly. Like whatever observes. Yeah.
Yeah, that part's super cool. I know you have to go, so I'm going to get to my fun parts because one of them you're really going to love. So there is one other plot thing that sort of dropped in here is on 398 to ask forgiveness for what had happened with his sister and his sister's little son, who is maybe dead and maybe not. It goes on about that, but that is a very direct like bit because we've heard about her son going missing. There's lots of assumptions, but like it's clear that he doesn't know if he's alive or gone.
Yeah, continue. Like another little breadcrumb to remind us that's kind of the we're following this trail.
Yep. Yeah. This is one of my favorite metaphors that I marked was, and now he considers that the excess. Oh yeah, so he's talking about reality and Lolita and all this stuff. And now he considers the consequence of excess information impeding all specialization, courtesy of people's addiction to the internet and drowning in Google, an effect similar to eating fruit salad without ever having tried the different fruits separately, without ever having individually their original shape and consistency. And so that all that nothing all together and all at once and all diced up into small uniform cubes.
Yeah, that's
also referring back to our conversation last week. This is where one of the little loops happens, because it says, and he met under bizarre circumstances someone who has a child and known Nabokov, the man who'd been in charge of the control room at the particle accelerator, the son of an American ex-employee of the Metropolis. And based on him and on that, he'd invented an entire story filling multiple BG pages. And that's been the story that we've now heard kind of recounted in two different ways earlier. Yeah. Cool. Have you ever read Ader Arter?
No, I have not.
Either. I really want to. I know that the writer never, it does next volume apparently, but it's one that I'm always intrigued by, but I never had found the time to do it.
So here's a funny like way to, I don't know, just how bizarre it is to read this book sometimes. I don't know what year was he here when he came through? And
2 years ago, 2018.
What's that?
2018.
Okay. So this was already written in Spanish.
Yes. No.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
2017, it says in the front, right? Yeah, 2017 translated 2019.
There's, yeah, because there's something I'm going to reference about that too. Okay, you do yours and I'll do mine. Okay.
Sure. So on 396, 397, like one of his two favorite stories, it says, of the writer was Signs and Symbols. And then the Vane Sisters. Mm-hmm. And I remember we were having a party at your house with some of the Maltz folks and some professors or whatnot were all coming over, and Rodrigo came over. And we were talking for a little bit about short stories, I love short stories, American short story writers in particular. Mm-hmm. And he saw you have the big thick volume of Nabokov stories. And he saw it on your bookshelf. And so, I think it's that one. Yep. And he pulls it out and he's like, oh, one of his best, this is, I was like, I love his books. Like, what are some of your favorite stories of his? He's like, oh, easy. The Vane Sisters. I'm like, oh, really? I haven't read that one. And he like pulls it out and shows it to me and starts talking about it and saying the end of it is like this crazy puzzle. And it's like an acrostic. Like, this is like one of like crazy gamesmanship that he does in his story is insane. And like almost nobody ever talks about it, or maybe they don't even realize it. I don't know. But, and so I was like, oh, okay. So like I went home and found it, got it, read it, whatever. I was like, this is amazing. And then here it is in this book talking about it for a couple pages. It's like, yes, I know the story behind this.
I just reread it right before this because I wanted to,
okay.
I all wanted. And like the thing is, yeah. Is it references the idea of this acrostic and this message twice in the story. And so the third time is the acrostic itself. And also at the very beginning, when it's talking about light and icicles, I'm like, what the fuck's this icicle shit all about? Like, this seems like unnecessary. And I think that then when if you start noticing the last part, you're like, oh, wait a second. Icicle ties together back to the beginning of the book. Yeah, it's great. It's a great story.
Like, I almost get the feeling sometimes with Nabokov that like, you get so good and so like masterful at something, you just have to start finding ways to amuse yourself, mm-hmm. perhaps, because like you have mastered it and you are in such control of this thing that's like, how can we make it harder? Like, oh, let's just do it left-handed now.
That's talked about in here too in relation to this. Look at the Harlequins, which I bought this version because it was in a used bookstore and Rodrigo's like, you need to read this book. So I got it, bought it, and I read it. And it's amazing because he talked about it in here, and he's absolutely right, is that it's like a parody. It's like Nabokov parodying himself. He's like, mm-hmm. he has this whole other books by the narrator, and they're like mapped onto the book that Nabokov wrote, but they're not the right names. So instead of The Gift, it's The Dare, Sea Under Real, A Kingdom by the Sea is one, Artist instead of Ada or Arter, like all like references, but they're not the right titles. And the whole book is like about a Nabokovian author who's basically trying to be Nabokov. It's like bad writing at times on purpose. Because it's like, you can't ever be me. you'll only ever be this pale shadow of what I'm doing. But it reminds me of the controversy that surrounded the last book from Bolaño, Woes of the True Policeman, where people are like, oh, it's like an early draft of 2666. It's just supposed to, it was going to be 2666, it became 2666, and it's just juvenilia, it's not good, blah, 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 blah. And or it's going to be the, like the last volume where they had like things written, most people didn't like it. And Valerie Miles told me that it was supposed to be him parodying himself the same way that Nabokov did. And that it was like doing the things that are in these other books of his, but not quite as good to show like how those other ones are so superior. I don't know how true that is. And I don't remember, I read the book under the first vision. And because I had that, I interpreted it that way because people had said, oh, it's this, it's minor work, it's not good. So I never really like, considered it fully, but I think that that's interesting. That's what he was really doing.
Yeah. Yeah. It's almost like he was too good at his trick or his game that nobody didn't give enough hint for people to get it and be in on the joke.
But, yep.
And it makes perfect sense too, that you see the connection here also, as a influence on the writer is Stanley Kubrick. Because I feel like the very same thing that Nabokov is doing with literature, you see Kubrick doing with film, where it's like he's so bored with like film that he's got to find a way to be, you know, to make it interesting, to make it a chess game, to do something that you can rewatch it, and find different layer upon layer upon layer, like while still having it be this perfect thing on the surface. Which, on the sentence level, you can read Nabokov and just be amazed.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So my one contribution to world literature exists inside this book. And I go into one specific contribution to world literature exists inside this book. And for everyone watching, or watching this now or later, you're going to get to see it in a second. But to put this in context, when we were editing and going through the inventive part, or I forget if it was when we were doing the 2 month review, whatever it was, there was a video came out in 2016. This video came out that was of a fake ritual sacrifice at CERN. And I sent it to Rodrigo. I was like, have you seen this? And he's like, no, I had no idea about that, but it works with my stuff. So he puts it in on 4/14, where it says, after the episode, his and his and only his, with him and only him as indisputable and shooting and falling dwarf star, when a video gag faking a human sacrifice next to that statue of Shiva at the facilities of the particle accelerator and hadron collider at CERN in Geneva. So here we go. I figured out how to share my screen, I believe. So if this works, Chrome has lost permission to share my screen. Oh, God damn it. Hold on, I'm gonna make this work.
That's perfect.
I'm gonna fix it.
Could not write a better joke than that. It's perfect.
You're right. You are right. Jokes are hard right now, man. Like, there's no new material. I came up with something last night, but I can't remember what it was. Click screen record.
So I realize there's a vast difference between the writer and Rodrigo's life, but it's hard not to make some connections between some of Rodrigo's own influences and what influences are in here. But so I got drunk at that party. Not like make a fool of myself drunk, but I made a fool of myself, which I'm great at doing even sober. And so, you know, it's annoying because I was writing short stories, I was reading a lot of short stories, and he knew more about American short story writers than I did, which is like, whatever. He's read more, been around longer. I'm fine with people knowing more than me. That's every day of my life. But I remember saying like, man, have you thought about maybe doing shorter form stuff, like writing some short stories? And he was like, well, yeah, I've written a collection of short stories.
It's incredibly popular and is the one that's referenced in here. Although the name
is the one.
So I'm gonna say this and I'm gonna restart my browser and I'll be back in 2 seconds and I'll be able to show the two videos I wanna show everyone. Because the second one in particular is just for you, Brian. But his stories were Historia Argentina, but he also has Trabajos Manual, which would be like manual labor, right? The National Industry seems to be a combination of those two titles for the book. But yeah, that was an incredibly popular book.
And they're not translated, correct?
No.
Okay. Because apparently I'm going to have to just buy a Spanish language copy of it and read it in Spanish and not know what's going on, which is basically how I read Rodrigo for the most part anyway. So par for the course for me. But yeah, it was very funny to see the end of it where he's mentioning the short stories, and I was just like, oh yeah, I remember when I put my foot in my mouth talking to him about short stories. But there is one great short story writer that most folks, myself included, hadn't read. It was Lee K. Abbott. He's a big fan of Lee K. Abbott. Uh-huh. And I was drunk, obviously, and so I wrote it down as Leaky. It's like, when he said it, I didn't realize it was a first name, a middle initial, and a last name. So I started like trying to find books by Leaky Abbott.
Oh my God.
Which I like the, I love the name Leaky Abbott way better than Lee K. Abbott.
Oh, but, absolutely.
If you want like a kind of dirty realism, but with a hint of like sci-fi and like taking place out in the desert, Lee K. Abbott, hit him up. He's worth checking out. All right, here we go.
So this is the video that I sent to him, and you can see like this is filmed on at CERN. That's the statue of Shiba. And when, as this goes along, I'm going to narrate this for people who aren't watching for just a minute. So here comes these shadowy figures out of like the background.
And there's some like druids.
And it's set up as if someone were like there and they just saw this out their window and they just started recording it. And like, what the fuck? And then like, yeah, they bring out, I'm gonna fast forward because we don't need to see the whole thing. So they bring out a person.
Mock human sacrifice ceremony.
So that was one. So that's one video I wanted to show. So where they had a mock ceremony to sacrifice a human at CERN. I told him about it and he put it in his book. So I feel really, I feel very professional and important now.
Very nice.
Very nice. Very true.
Well, if one day in the not too distant future.
That was the people still being sacrificed. I forgot to turn it off.
If he has a character that he calls like the young idiot or something, that's totally me. Can't wait. that takes another drink and leans in too close, is talking in his face, all sorts of nonsense, not knowing anything. It's like, oh yeah, that's me. That was me. Hell yeah. That'll be my contribution.
Oh my God. One other person I really love in this chapter is on 415, where he starts to answer. He's like, they always ask the wrong questions and you don't ever understand what I say. They mistranslated his reading, the learning to read English or to understand English, because of the back cover of Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band as, I remember learning English reading the booklet Farmer Peppermint, which is really funny. And so then he's like, well, you just don't answer the questions that they ask. And then that answer, what's my area of interest, my territory as a writer, my style, my subject? I could offer a brief answer. What interests me is texture, especially the text, but that wouldn't be entirely correct or precise answer. I think something is like, and then that goes on the next 2.5 pages. And it includes a bit that says, now you hear, concerning what intrigues you, what you don't understand about my digressive style and psychotic theme. Allow me to quote you from memory, brief fragment, but he's like making this joke about like how he's like basically not answering this dude's question, talking all these like random stories and digressing. And there's this funny, two funny things in here that remind me. There's this bit about like, that you eat four spiders a year. I've read somewhere recently that we are always within 4 feet of a spider. Like no matter where you are, you're within 4 feet of a spider.
Hmm.
Which is unnerving.
No, I'm not afraid of spiders.
Not all of them. Some of them.
Yeah, I almost lost my foot. I got bit by a brown recluse in college, actually. So I should be afraid of spiders. But after that, I'm okay with it, I guess. Whatever.
Now, the other thing I wanted to show you goes back a minute here, is where it's talking about the Rolling Stones. And he's making fun of the Rolling Stones.
Yes.
And that is wonderful. But it talks about how they had his favorite variation of the performance of the unrivaled James Brown was the one in the 1964 documentary film, The TAMI Show. There along with the centrifugal of the famous clones, Brown decided to go out and kill it because they were not giving the closing number because they played to him. That privilege corresponded to novel and hip at the time, the Rolling Stones. So Brown decided to go out and kill it and kill them, entering next to last from the right and dancing on just one foot. and like just totally destroyed it. So since James Brown wasn't like the headliner, he totally destroyed it. So this is extended, but this is the video you showed me, which when at first thing I saw James Brown, I think of this video. And if people have not seen or heard this video, I'm gonna play a good bit of it. It might be the funniest thing, and it will work. It will work on the podcast that's just audio.
It resulted, as a matter of fact, in Brown assaulting his wife with a lead pipe and firing a gun at a car that he was in. These are charges that Brown denies. He was released yesterday on $15,000 bond. He joins us from Atlanta to discuss the charges, and we welcome you, James Brown. How did all of this trouble begin?
Living in America! Nothing wrong.
Nothing wrong at all. You're not in any difficulty, but you're out on bond.
No, I'm not.
Have all the charges been dropped?
Yeah, I'm out on love.
Well, are you out on love or out of love? Which is it?
Out on love. Alone from night to night, you find me.
Now, James, this isn't the first time you and your wife have had a problem. Are the two of you going to be able to work this out?
Talk about the music.
You want to talk about music, and you don't want to talk about what happened.
No, it's all over.
Well, let's talk about your tour. When are you leaving?
We're leaving tomorrow.
And where are you going?
Rio de Janeiro and Sao Paulo, Brazil.
Now, your fans will have read all about this, James. Aren't you concerned about that?
No, Dankeschön. I'm concerned because there's nothing wrong.
And what are you going to say to your fans when they ask you some questions about it?
I'm going to say, I feel good. Papa's got a brand new bag. It's a man's world.
That's the second time we've heard that in 2 days. That's very easy. Now, don't leave us, James. You stay right there. We have more we have to talk about. Well, tell us a little bit about what you're going to be doing on this tour. What are you going to be doing on this tour?
I'm going to be doing Papa's got a brand new bag, living in America. Sex machine, get up off of that thing. I feel good. Jam.
Now, I understand that you already, James, I have to ask you one serious question here. I understand you already have started divorce proceedings. Does that mean that you're now eligible?
I'm single. I want to mingle.
You want to mingle?
Yeah.
Now, the women love you when you get out there. Why do you think that is?
What'd you say?
The women love you when you get out there.
Why is that, lady?
Well, I'm asking you.
Huh?
Because what do you think that is? You
look good. I smell good. I feel good.
And you sing good.
And make love good.
Oh. Well, very well. We don't have to ask anybody else. We got that from the source. Now, you're involved in publishing a gospel magazine. Tell us a little bit about that.
The Second Coming. It's out of Augusta, Georgia's anchor. Joseph P. Young is the editor. And James Brown is one of the advisors. And we're doing a fantastic job. The Second Coming.
That is so much cocaine.
So much cocaine went into that.
Much cocaine in that interview. Holy cow. And there is cocaine in this section too. Which, so maybe that's the segue
which is the segue to my favorite line. Because I know since we have to keep this one short for you, my favorite line is on 386, where it's, I'm not going to read the whole, actually I will. He remembered with a little laugh. Back then, he had a mechanical typewriter, and he rewarded the nose of his brain with a line every time he reached the bottom of a page, and after half a page, and one terrible and fantastic night, every time that little bell rang, as if for the end of a round or like a rifle reloading, when he came to the end of a line, and oh, how fast he wrote back then when there was no blank page he didn't make himself the center of, that someone, concerned about his addict-level consumption of cocaine, had even considered staging one of those interventions. But the idea was dismissed when it was discovered he didn't have enough family or friends to attend it.
I underline that too.
Yep. I feel you, buddy.
I'll keep mine brief. 378. Nothing interests a writer less than having stories, apart from the stories he reads, told to him.
Absolutely. So amazing section, amazing book.
Yes.
Let me find really quick season 11. Everything, I didn't start everything to be able to give my permission to share that James Brown interview. Well worth it. Next week, we're going up to page 487. And we might have a guest. I have no idea yet. I don't know what day it is. I don't know what's happening most of the time now. So give it a try.
Well, either way, I feel good. Beastie Boys had the gun cold, kicking it live.